half a dozen. It's a phrase you use about eggs, things you might pick up from the supermarket, not Tour de France victories. But coming into the 2004 race, Lance Armstrong was just one win away from being the first man in Tour history who'd be able to count his wins on the fingers of more than one hand. He was already in pretty exalted company, of course. Only four other men had ever won five Tours. But although they'd all ridden again after their fifth win, none of them, not even the great Eddie Merckx, had been able to muster a sixth. As it happened, Lance Armstrong's ride into history began in Merckx's backyard. The prologue for the Tour was in the Belgian city of Liège, 6 kilometres flat out through the city streets. However, all the historical evidence says that it's going to be a massive task to pull off, and even the famously focused Armstrong arrived in Liège struggling to keep it all in perspective.
It's never been done. It's legendary, but I can't think about that. I have to think about, I mean, sitting here today, I have to think about the prologue. Okay, what's the prologue like? After that, I have to think about the TTT. And if we make it to the end and it shakes out that I win again, then, man, I guess I can comment on it then and say how I feel. But I refuse to think about that and put myself in that position now, because I think that's the worst karma you could ever create. And sort of, I mean, how the hell can you write your victory speech before you've ridden 3 weeks of hard bike races? And I'm not doing that. There's, especially this year, there's a lot of guys that are good, and it's going to be tight.
So who, if anybody, can beat Armstrong? Well, while the American's going for his sixth win, Germany's Jan Ullrich will be trying to avoid his sixth second place in this race. The 1997 champion pushed Armstrong incredibly close last year, and he leads the pack of contenders again this year.
I hope. I made good training before, and I feel me good. I have a strong team, and I hope I can win.
Spain's Iban Mayo has already beaten Armstrong this year. In fact, he hammered him in an uphill time trial last month. But Mayo knows that beating Lance in June and repeating the trick in July are totally different propositions.
Yo saldré con la aspiración máxima y veremos hasta dónde puedo llegar. Pero bueno, yo tanto como ganar no diría, ¿no? Me gustaría alguna etapa y estar en el podium. Igual es más posible ganar. Me queda un poco grande igual todavía.
Armstrong's old teammate Tyler Hamilton is more upbeat about his chances. Hamilton finished an astonishing fourth last year after riding with a broken collarbone for 3 weeks. This year, he has a new team custom built to help him take on his old leader.
My objective, the team's objective, is to win. It's clear. You're confident. I'm confident in the team. I'm confident in myself. Really, it comes down to me. There's a lot. Certainly, there's a lot of pressure on me, but I feel like I have the best of everything. So now, no excuses now for me.
Another US postal defector has joined the enemy this year. Roberto Heras used to be Armstrong's chief protector in the mountains. Now, as leader of his own team, the Spanish climber will be one more dangerous attacker for the defending champion to worry about.
No lo sé. Venimos preparados para intentarlo. Hay muchos candidatos a la victoria. Vamos a intentarlo, al menos.
And he's got to take on the course as well this year, which some people think has been designed to make it more difficult for him. They've taken out the first week time trial, which is usually where he builds up a big lead over his rivals. Let's take a look at the route now.
Well, the Tour certainly gets its money's worth out of Belgium this year, with the prologue and two stages before the race leaves Waterloo for Vascal, heading back into France by the bone-shaking cobbles of the famous Paris-Roubaix one-day race. There's a rule change in the team time trial this year, which may help some of Lance Armstrong's rivals. Then the sprinters will lead the pack on a high-speed chase cross-country all the way to the Atlantic coast. Week two starts with a plane journey to Limoges for the first of two rest days. Then it's south through the vineyards, ignoring the pre-tasting signs, and into the Pyrenees. This is where the battle between the defending champion and the men who reckon they're strong enough to attack him will really start. The highlights will be consecutive mountain top finishes at La Mongie and Plateau de Bay, both stages that Armstrong has won before. After another day's rest, the riders head up to the Alps and the first individual time trial of the race. It's only 15 kilometres long. Those 15 kilometres are up the legendary climb of Alpe d'Huez. The Tour's most famous mountain has never been used for a time trial before, and this promises to be a classic stage. No sooner are the riders out of the Alps than they face the Tour's second individual time trial. The 60 kilometres against the clock around Besançon could well decide the race, and if they don't, then it'll have to be decided on the Champs-Élysées.
Now, usually the prologue is full of home interest in the form of David Miller. Not this year, though. As you might have read in the newspapers, Britain's world time trial champion is out of the race after confessing to the use of the performance-enhancing drug EPO. And while the rest of the riders were lining up for their pre-race medicals here in Liège, David was locked in judges' chambers across the French border in Nanterre, answering a series of highly uncomfortable questions. The rest of his Cofidis team is here, of course, but understandably not starting the race in the best frame of mind.
Shocked and, yeah, feel sorry for Dave. It's a good friend of mine and always will be, and you know, think times like this is going to need more support than anything. So, just thinking of him.
Now, David has more than just missing the tour to worry about. He's already out of Britain's Olympic team for Athens, and once he's had time to speak to Cofidis management, he'll very likely be out of a job.
Well, the prologue course in Liège may well have suited David Miller, but of course we'll never know now. 6.1 kilometres, some cobbled stretches and a couple of tricky corners that could turn treacherous if it rained. And having lost David Miller to the legal system, Cofidis proceeded to lose a rider on the warm-up ride. The Australian Matt White, who should have been starting his first Tour de France, came off after hitting a television cable just off the route and headed off to hospital instead with a suspected broken collarbone. Once the race started, another Aussie went down, Michael Rogers touching the tarmac with a pedal and losing himself any chance of taking the early race lead. As we join the action, that is in the possession of the Spaniard Oscar Pereiro, a member of Tyler Hamilton's Phonak squad.
Well, we're looking now at Fabian Cancellara here, Paul. He has, he won't know, of course, the drama at the other end with Jens Voigt just losing first place by 0.02 seconds. Whatever did we do without the clocks in the old days with the old finger and thumb on the stopwatch? Because there's no way we could split these riders without the electronic timing these days. Cancellara has been talked about by a lot of people as the one man who could challenge the big boys in the prologue time trial. And I think they may have just reason to do that now.
We expected this man to put in a fine performance, and look at that, he's well inside. He's the fastest man to that corner so far, and I think he's not going to fade at all. He's a very big, strong bike rider. Phil, this is a new best time.
This is a new best time. His first ever day in his first ever Tour de France. He's on top of the leaderboard, 6:50.93. That is a superb time. Jan Ullrich, he says, I'm tired of finishing second, and he knows better than most. He's done it five times. It's a long time since he won this race in 1997. I don't know if you can hear the crowd, but we can. They are screaming at Jan Ullrich. He is the pin-up boy of world cycling. They say he has more talent in his body than any current cyclist.
One man to add to that is Lance Armstrong, who has always regarded this man here in pink and white of T-Mobile as the most talented bike rider on the circuit. He is a powerful bike rider. He came from an East German upbringing to win the Tour de France a few years ago. But since then, he's been dogged by illness and injury and defeat as well. Three times at the hands of Lance Armstrong. And you're right, Phil, this year he doesn't want to be beaten again. He wants to be the number one dog.
Well, he's on his way, Jan Ullrich, and that means there's only one man left to start his test now, and time is nearly up. Armstrong is in the start house. We'll see him very shortly. Ahead of Ullrich is Hamilton, ahead of Hamilton is Mayo, behind them all is Armstrong, almost impervious to the noise going on about him as he now concentrates the countdown. Armstrong launches into his Tour de France. Will it be a record-breaking race for him? He looks for win number six. He says, I'm not thinking of Paris, I'm taking this day by day and assessing it as I go. Well, he's off.
Look at the powerhouse from Germany here. This
look at those legs, look at those muscles.
Paul.
They're like pistons, they're huge muscles there that are pumping around these pedals. They're all to reach the 3.1 kilometer check at the moment, and that's where we'll get our first indication. Mayo's there. Mayo's gone through 13 seconds off Cancellara's race time. Cancellara still looking set to win this prologue.
Look at the comparison between the two riders. We've just got a glimpse there of the way they were pedaling. Iban Basso, he's a man who I think can finish in the top five, is coming into the finishing straight. Won't be too happy with this time. He's going to finish fairly close to 50th position. But more importantly, he's going to lose himself almost half a minute on Fabian Cancellara.
This is Lance Armstrong. Those legs, once they catch up with the cadence, he just sits there and pumps.
He has got an incredible cadence here. He's able to accelerate quickly.
Paul Ullrich has gone through, same time as Tyler Hamilton at 3.1 kilometres covered. They are locked together. Now we're waiting for Lance to get there.
10 seconds adrift. 10 seconds those two men have gone through slower than Fabian Cancellara. We're looking here at Alessandro Petacchi. This sprint in a couple of days' time will be in front of a huge bunch.
He's practicing there.
Practicing the lunch for the line. It's 55th place for him. But we're now waiting. In the next 30 seconds or so, we should get an indication of how Lance Armstrong is riding. He actually looks pretty good to me.
He looks very fast to me, but we don't know. Ullrich and Tyler Hamilton virtually same time at that check. No time. Armstrong is there. He is lying in second place. He is only 2 seconds off the win. It is possible.
Watch out for the corner. This is the corner that has been the undoing for several riders. He went round there very carefully. Didn't touch his brakes. He went in at the right speed. He's in the right gear to accelerate away. We're now looking at Iban Mayo, fourth from the end. A good ride, though, by him.
Well, this is amazing now. Mayo is doing a good ride. The man that can't ride a time trial is at least not going to lose that many seconds. But Cancellara is just about holding off the man from the Tour de France. Lance Armstrong has gone through only 2 seconds down, and the good riders should accelerate as they come up towards the line. I don't think, deep down, Paul, we expected a win from Armstrong today.
I don't think Armstrong expected it, but he did want to go out today and serve a bitter psychological blow to everybody else. You know, at 3.1 kilometres, Cancellara still has the fastest time of 3.18, but Armstrong is only 2 seconds slower than him at this point. And I'm sure that information has gone forward to this man, the big German challenger.
Oh dear, Paul, 8 seconds difference at the halfway mark. Greg LeMond once won the Tour de France by 8 seconds. It could be that important.
It could be so important. It's all down to seconds. The sport has come to such a level now, okay, that it could even be fractions of a second. This man has the most ungainly time trial position and style in the world, but it's probably one of the most efficient.
It is indeed, and Hamilton is not going to lose too much time. Nowhere near Cancellara's time, but only 17 seconds. It'll be rounded up to 18 seconds for the overall classification. That's not a lot. He won't be worried about that. He will be concerned about the form, though, being shown by Armstrong.
Two men left to finish. Number 11, the challenger. 6 times he's ridden the Tour de France, Phil. 6 times he's been onto the podium. Never lower than second place in the overall classification. He dearly wants to beat this man, Lance Armstrong, who has been the dominator for the last 5 years in a row.
In 6 miles, or 6 kilometres rather, of the Tour de France, we have already developed a great battle between these two terrific athletes. First and second in the Tour de France. 3 times Ullrich has finished second to Lance Armstrong. He's currently second in the time trial. He'll go back a little bit, but it shows you right now that Ullrich himself has continued to accelerate as he comes up to the line. It is not going to be a race-winning time, though. He's also just trying to conserve time here as Ullrich finishes 15th, just slightly better than Hamilton.
Only one man now can beat Fabian Cancellara, who's not too far away from the finishing straight, and the man who can beat him is Lance Armstrong. The time he has to beat is 6 minutes, 50 seconds, 0.9. Armstrong is watching that clock tick over. Look at that face. The pain is going all through his body. It's telling him, please stop, please give me a break. But look at the time.
Paul,
it's unbelievable.
This is a winning time. As he comes up to the line, Lance Armstrong, who won in Luxembourg in 2002, is going to throw down the gauntlet. You know, that book has made him a very, very angry man. As he races up to the line, he's going to have to sprint. It's going to be desperately close. He's missed it. As he hits the line, 1.65 seconds, Fabian Cancellara in his first Tour de France. He's 23 years of age, has won the prologue. In the battle of psychology, Lance Armstrong wins that.
He wins the first battle, but it's going to be a very long war, this 3-week event. Look at that face. Look at the man as he comes up to the line here. That is an absolutely superb ride. And he has, Phil, delivered a serious psychological blow to everybody else. He's announced to them that he is the strong man. But here is the winner. Oh. Here is the new yellow jersey, Fabian Cancellara, Phil, 23 years of age.
I tell you, Paul, this is wonderful. He was born on March the 18th, 1981. He's been a professional since the year 2001. He was a sensational teenage star. He is now about to become a Tour de France stage winner at the very first day of his very first tour.
He'll probably want this result signed by the entire peloton to put up on his wall. Fabian Cancellara 2 seconds ahead of the defending Tour de France champion Lance Armstrong, with Jose Ivan Gutierrez in third, 8 seconds back. Then Brad McGee, Tor Hushovd, Oscar Pereiro and Jens Voigt separated by another couple of seconds. For Armstrong, though, the real race wasn't with Cancellara. It was with Ullrich, Hamilton and Mayo, and they all had disappointing rides. 15, 16 and 19 second deficits on the American may not seem a lot, but they're a lot over 6 kilometres, and who knows how important they may become down the road. Fabian Cancellara couldn't have cared less about the bigger picture, though. He was on the podium posing for the biggest picture of his life, and starting an endless round of interviews, including one with Ned Bolton.
Your first Tour de France, your first day of your Tour de France, you couldn't have dreamed that it would end like this.
Yeah, it's more than a dream, because before, when I was young, I have only seen TV, in television, the Tour de France, with Miguel Indurain to win, or with now with Lance Armstrong. Now I'm here. This is now it's 3 days, and it's all new. It's all special. It's more. It's unbelievable. It's too much.
Now, the Tour attracts its fair share of celebrity spectators: Robin Williams, Eric Idle, Arnold Schwarzenegger last year. However, as far as we know, none of those stars was romantically involved with Lance Armstrong. Sheryl Crow is. And just to help him keep a low profile, she's tagging along this year. Ned Bolton caught up with her before the start.
I think cycling is like what rock and roll probably used to be like when the Stones were in their heyday. I mean, now rock and roll or music has become sort of, I mean, it's kind of silly, really. They're great personalities in the sport, and you really get to know who they are, and then you start following them like you do, or you would have your music idols. And people are very dedicated and very emotionally committed to their cyclist, and it's not dissimilar than probably what it used to be like. I think with Lance's situation, he has the opportunity, and certainly the capability, but the opportunity now to do something that's never been done before, and that's, I think, as history goes and as originality goes, there's nothing like doing something that's never been done. I think everybody really wants him to win, just to see someone do something that it has always been seen as the impossible. You know, you've had great cyclists before win 5, but this will really be history in the making. And if anybody can do it, it would be Lance. And I think also we've gotten the opportunity to watch Lance grow as a person through his career, and that's something we all relate to. So there, yeah, I mean, I'm probably more nervous about it than he is.
There was plenty for Sheryl to be nervous about on stage one, which was officially flat but actually featured 5 small climbs and the kind of squally weather that has crash written all over it. It also featured the novelty of Lance Armstrong wearing the green jersey of the points competition leader, courtesy of coming second in the prologue. As winner on the opening day, Fabian Cancellara was officially leader of all categories, and since he couldn't wear all the relevant jerseys, Lance was forced into his cast-offs. Well, the crashes weren't long in coming. Mario Cipollini went down off camera, possibly the first thing he's done off camera in his entire career. Then Jens Voigt and Frank Renier simply pointed themselves at the grass verge when they realised they had no chance of making this corner. Worse off was Austria's Bernhard Eisel, who seemed to lose traction on the white lines in the middle of the road before touching somebody's back wheel and going down. Fabian Cancellara was up front at the intermediate sprints, protecting his yellow jersey. Remember, there are time bonuses of 6, 4 and 2 seconds for the first 3 riders under the banner at each of the designated sprints out on the road. And with Tor Hushovd starting the day just 10 seconds behind him, he couldn't let the Norwegian champion go unchallenged. Hushovd took the 6 seconds here, Cancellara 4 for second place, a 2-second net gain to Hushovd. At the next sprint, though, Cancellara was second again, with Hushovd nowhere to be seen. So 4 seconds back to Cancellara. With bigger bonuses available for the first 3 riders across the line at the finish, though, Cancellara and his Fassa Bortolo team couldn't afford to relax. As we join commentary with less than 5 kilometres to go, they're riding hard at the front of the pack to try to reel in a 2-man breakaway consisting of Denmark's Jakob Piel and Mark Wouters of Belgium.
Cancellara has shown us how to time trial yesterday. Earlier on today, he's also shown us how to sprint at 5 kilometers to go. He is also in here, and there he is in yellow. Ulrich's team are moving to the front, but not for Jan Ullrich, but for ace sprinter Erik Zabel, 6 times a winner of the points competition.
Yatislav Ekimov just kicking it up there to bring the pace up a little bit higher. I caught the long, slim figure of the T-Mobile rider, Rolf Aldag, who happens to be sharing a room at the moment with Erik Zabel. We've not spoken about Erik Zabel very much, but you can never discount him in a sprint. And last time the Tour de France came to Charleroi, who was the winner?
Erik Zabel on his birthday. Well, it's not the same date this year. His birthday runs on the 7th of July. I think it's the same date every year, so he can't win on his birthday today.
It's strange the way that works, isn't it?
Isn't it funny?
I think Erik Zabel will certainly be super motivated coming back here. You know, if you've won in a place in your career, you're always motivated when a race goes back there. These two riders now have been suffering for a long time. They're looking back and they know the main field is whipping up the pace. They know the main field is not too far behind them. And they know that very shortly, the teams of the sprinters must get themselves organized on the front end of the peloton. 4 kilometers to go, 2.5 miles, 15 seconds advantage.
It's at times like this when you've worked this hard, they should give them the victory, but I'm afraid it doesn't work like that in professional sport, and they're out to hunt them down at 15 seconds. It's all over. It's only a matter of when. Mark Wouters, it worked for him last time when he won in Antwerp. It's not going to work this time. Jakob Piel, it worked for him last time when he won down in Marseille. It's not going to work for him this time either. I've noticed Gerald Steiner also had a crash. There's a crash in the field. I don't know if we'll see it, but we're hearing shouts on the race radio. There's the split in the peloton. And there is the chaos. And somebody has gone down. Oh, it's a Phonak rider. Now, let's hope it's not... I don't think it's Tyler Hamilton. No, it's not Tyler Hamilton who's gone down. Nicolas Jalabert.
But this is what it's all about on the run into the finish. Just a small touch of wheels and somebody can go down. But everybody was alert at that moment. You see,
just
only one bike rider went down. Now we're approaching the outskirts of Charleroi. 3 kilometers to go. This is not going to take them very much more than 3 minutes. These two riders have not given up at all. And they have still got a breadth of chance in them. They're just hoping they can survive. But look at this. On the front, Cancellara is now whipping up the pace. And it's not to conserve his yellow jersey. It's to try and set up the line, what is normally the blue and white line of the big man from Italy, Alessandro Patacchi, the new sprinter on the block.
Unlucky Jalabert here, because that means he'll lose time today. Not a great concern, but a shame. Unnecessary loss of time. There was one other rider, I think, either delayed or fell, but he got up as well and he got out before we recognised who it was. But take a look at this now. Fabian Cancellara, the winner yesterday, his first Tour de France. Not riding, not thinking long term. He'll still be in yellow tomorrow, but right now his world would be complete if Alessandro Patacchi won the stage. He's the boss.
He's the boss. He's the king of the sprint. 2 kilometres to go, that sign will tell the riders. And unfortunately, when they take the next left-hand bell, it goes right the way up towards the finishing line. It's a long, hard line, a long, hard final kilometre. Cancellara on the front, shadowed there by Matteo Tosato, and not far away at the back end of that blue line will be Alessandro Patacchi. And all of the sprinters, Phil, will be fighting to get into his wheel, and it looks to me like now it is all over for the two leaders, and that is tough.
At 1.5 kilometres from the finish and a long straight up to the line shortly, they have pulled back those two leaders. There is the catch as they come round that left-hander. So close, yet so far. Wouters looks across at the bunch. He'll see what he expects. The riders from Fassa Bortolo leading the charge as they are caught. And now it's AG2R for Kersipu, who has come to the front. That's thrown a big spanner in the works for Fassa.
A lot of sprinters in the Tour this year. You can see the big organisation coming from AG2R, but they're getting swept away. They don't have the firepower of Fassa Bortolo, and there's still a lot of blue and white jerseys of Fassa Bortolo on the front end of the main field. There is a line of pink jerseys too there as well. That's Team Mobile. That is the team of Erik Zabel. Erik Zabel will be looking for the victory, but there's a good organisation coming in for Fassa Bortolo. They're looking for the final kilometre. They're kicking up the pace. This is a routine they put to success in the Giro d'Italia on 9 separate occasions. Erik Zabel there, Phil, is trying to get the jump up to the wheel of Alessandro Patacchi.
He's got it under 1 kilometre to go now. Zabala's got it. It's the first pink jersey we can see there. Also, Stuart O'Grady's trying to burst in onto the scene. And Jimmy Castor is there. Also, Tor Hushoth has started to bounce his way up towards the leaders. Wiped away now the names we've talked about. Lance Armstrong and Ullrich taking a back seat now because this is a matter for the sprinters. You don't get mixed up with the men of steel who have no nerve, who won't win the Tour de France, but they can win these stages. Zabala is to the right. Danilo Hondo is there. So too is Fabio Baldato. This is going to be one terrific sprint.
Well, coming up through the middle there, you can see Baden Cook as well, the man who won the green jersey points competition last year. The blue jersey of Gerald Steiner is Danilo Hondo. Tor Hushoft has moved up into second position. Everybody is looking for position, and I think Alessandro Pataki is out of place.
But Tor Hushoft isn't. Hushoft is on the left of our picture here. Kersipu running in the centre of our picture now. This could be a tremendous duel, and Robbie McEwen coming late on the line. I think it's Kersipu, so does he. Boy, McEwen came late, but he could have stolen it on the photo. He won a stage of the Tour of Switzerland when the other guy thought he'd won this year. Robbie kept going. I think I'm going to give it to Kersipu, but that was desperately close. And Hushoft was right there as well. And he will move right up the overall classification, probably to second. Now, there is McEwen on the right. This is Jan Kersipu pushing through the middle. Hushoft is over to the left. The camera needs to show us down below. We're not interested in this because we need to know where those wheels are.
Look at the face of Jan Kersipu. I'm pretty sure he knows with confidence that he was ahead. Let's have a look from the helicopter angle here. Hushoff starting the sprint there on the right-hand side. He's got a great line there right up against the barriers. That means nobody can overtake him on the inside, only coming round the left-hand side, which is exactly what Jan Kersipu is trying to do. Kersipu admirably set up here by his teammate. A last lunge for the line here coming by Robbie McEwen. McEwen is up alongside the Estonian rider, but as you can see the lunge for the line, it was too desperate. Jan Kersipu gets win number one. Nice move by him.
Well, the helicopter shot confirmed it. Jan Kersipu just ahead of a fast-closing Robbie McEwen, with Tor Hushoft in third. Fabian Cancellara's teammate, Alessandro Pataki, the world's leading sprinter this season, was back in eighth, apparently having lost the fight for position in the home straight. All the contenders for overall victory finished safely in the main pack, so no time gaps there.
Jan, before this stage, everyone was talking about Pataki, but you were the man who crossed the line first.
Normal, because he has so many victories this year, and as well Tom Boonen. And well, maybe they were too much marked, and I had a little more liberty, maybe. And that and the sprint as well suited me, because with a little uphill and with a headwind. So this is a sprint, not very fast sprint, but you need to have a much power and strength. So that suited me as well.
Trailing in 6 minutes behind Jan Kersipu was Brad McGee, one of the pre-race favourites for the prologue, now a leading candidate for first rider to abandon. A second day on the podium for Fabian Cancellara, though, and after the yellow jersey he promised his mum, he can now start thinking about who gets number two. Afterwards, he spoke to Ned.
Fabian, you said you wanted to stay in yellow. You've done it. How does it feel?
Wow, I'm happy. I think I'm also more happy because another day in yellow jersey is it's very good. It's crazy. It's a crazy day. It's crazy. These 2 days too much crazy, but it's good. It's a good feeling, and I hope I can this have tomorrow after the stage another day.
Well, a look at the general classification shows that Cancellara's lead has doubled. He started the day 2 seconds ahead of Armstrong. Now he's 4 seconds ahead of Tor Hushoft. Hushoft picked up an 8-second bonus for being third on the stage. And if Fabian hadn't battled for all those intermediate sprints out on the road, he might have lost his lead. Lance Armstrong now slips to third, 10 seconds back. Not that that'll worry him. And his lead over his main challengers remains the same.
Now, stage two looked like being another long, windy day's work for the Fassa Bortolo team, chasing down breakaways to keep their man Cancellara in the yellow jersey. Bad news for Alessandro Pataki, who would really rather have some fresh legs in front of him for the sprint finish. Mario Cipollini wouldn't mind some fresh legs either. Unfortunately for the world's former fastest man, he's stuck with the ones he's got, and they're now 37 years old. But although he's not as quick as he once was, Cippo still packs a mean wardrobe. And it's good to have him bringing some colour back to the Tour after 4 years away. Here's Ned.
Yes, the Lion King is back. The big Italian with the understated personality and the shy, retiring racing style has returned to his old hunting ground. It's fully a decade since Super Mario won his first stage on the Tour de France in 1993, and in the following 6 years, he notched up another 11, the last of which came in 99 when he blasted to four consecutive wins in the first week of the Tour. One of those was the fastest road stage in Tour history.
Of course, there are always three traditional questions which we always used to ask of Mario Cipollini. Number one, how many stages will he win?
Per me riuscire a vincere soltanto una tappa varrebbe come vincerne 10, perché sarebbe una dimostrazione di caparbietà, di voglia e di capacità nel voler ottenere un risultato.
It'll be tough. Gone is the big red train, the hallmark of his dominance throughout the 90s, the distinctive sight of half a dozen scarlet psychos bearing down on unsuspecting French towns. If he's going to do it, much will depend on his new teammates at Domino Vacanzi. No glorious technicolour, Cipollini is now in black and white. Gone too is his youth, now 37. Age has not withered him, but it's probably slowed him down a touch. Add to that the emergence of Alessandro Petacchi as the new chip off the old Chippo block, and he's in for a struggle. Petacchi has been sweeping all before him. Quadruple stage winner last year at the Tour, he's just come back from 9 stage wins in the Giro d'Italia.
Petacchi credo che sia estremamente all'altezza, una squadra imperniata su di lui. Esce da un Giro d'Italia estremamente vincente, per cui sarà sicuramente il faro di questi sprint e noi cerchiamo di rendergli la vita più difficile possibile.
Number two, what awful sort of clothes will he wear and how much is it going to cost him in fines?
The undisputed world wardrobe champion has picked up where he left off. His controversial full spandex all-in-one body hugger, which he donned for Saturday's prologue, was deemed just too all-in-one for the Tour. At the age of nearly 40, he was forced to wear shorts for the day. Extreme measures, but the Tour simply wouldn't allow him to start without the intervention of the scissors. Just another clothing crime in a long list of previous offences. The mellow yellow, the stars and stripes, the green machine, and how could we forget Julius Caesar? Gone too are the long locks that could launch 1,000 attacks and sell 1,000 coffee machines.
And finally, exactly how far up the first mountain will he give up?
The answer, of course, is not very far. The slightest twitch on the altimeter and Cipo's heading for an early bath. And by the way, don't believe him when he says...
Per accontentare i giornalisti, i media, gli sportivi, una volta per forza bisogna arrivare a Parigi. Speriamo che sia l'anno buono.
Cipo has never completed the Tour, and just when you think it'll end in tears, with him it normally does. A nice little side bet might be the battle for the back seat in the broom wagon between Petacchi and Cipo.
So, given that this is almost certainly Mario Cipollini's last appearance at the Tour de France, like that final one for the road, enjoy it while it lasts.
Well, it'd be nice to see Cipo register a win before he retires from the Tour. At stage two, 197 kilometres from Charleroi to Namur, was developing nicely for his successor Alessandro Petacchi and for Fabian Cancellara. A six-man break was out front, none of them a threat to Cancellara's race lead, so Fassa Bortolo could relax, let other teams do the chasing and save their legs to set Petacchi up at the finish, providing the break got caught. As we join the race, they're approaching the final intermediate sprint of the day, inside 40 kilometres to go and with a lead of 1:45 over the chasing pack.
Looking here now at Christophe Mangeon, still a member of the six-man leading break. Marc Scanlon sitting right behind him. Now, somewhere in the distance is the last sprint of the day for those small time bonuses, the small prize and a small number of points for the green jersey competition. And it looks as though it is going to be a rather nasty uphill sprint this last 500 metres.
Going to be tricky. You can see once again on the front there, Christophe Mangeon is the man leading it out, looking over his shoulder. Scanlon in second position. Pinot in third. But they need to watch out for the man who's been 100% successful so far. The rider from Cofidis is in the ideal position here to surprise him.
What he'll have to do if he wins this, he's got to hang on. Oh, there's been a mass crash at the back of the peloton here. One of the Domino Vacanzi riders down again. I'm just trying to see who it is, but it's certainly not on this occasion.
It's Fanini. Fanini, that's the lead-out man for Mario Cipollini, who's gone down there quite dramatically.
Gianmatteo Fanini, meanwhile, while he sits in the grass back at the front, Jakob Pihl leads out here, but he's going to get pipped again. And this is a fine piece of sprinting by Cofidis, as indeed Edelin makes it a hat-trick. Back to the crash, Fanini.
Perron. That's Andrea Perron who's gone down there for Team CSC. There's somebody else is rather seriously injured. He's still at the side of the road there, Gianmatteo Fanini, who's pretty hard hit. Fortunately, he was able to dive across, I think, into the side of the road and get himself into the grass. But this is rather dramatic for Mario Cipollini because he is an ideal. Andrea Piron, let's have a look here. There's a Voeckler rider gone down as well.
Well, let's hope it's not Tyler. It doesn't look like Tyler Hamilton. A 1-2-3 stepping off his bike there. That was Anthony Chapteau. Gerard Porte, the doctor here, just checking on Fanini and again checking his collarbone.
That's the biggest injury. All bike riders fear this when they go down, just because of the way that you go down. That is the bone that more often than not will crack, and I think it might be the situation here that this man could have just snapped his collarbone.
Well, it doesn't look like he's getting up. I think this is the call in the doctor's car there. It looks as though he might be out, and this is a big blow for Cipollini, that's for sure.
Well, with less than 25 kilometres to go, the inevitable happened when the pack, led by the sprinters' team, swallowed up the six-man break, and everything was in place for a big bunch finish. The man with the most to gain from it, though, was in trouble. Torhüschoff, to Crédit Agricole, just 4 seconds off the race lead, remember, was involved in a crash that damaged his bike and forced him to swap to a replacement that didn't seem to suit him.
What sprinters like to see in the last kilometre of a race is a long, wide boulevard like this, straight up to the finish line, so they can judge how to make their effort by pinpointing exactly where the line is. Unfortunately, that's not the situation today, because at 400 metres to go, the road actually starts to curve around. It curves around up until 150 metres to the line. Only then can they actually see the line and know when to open up the sprint. If Alessandro Petacchi wants to win this race this afternoon, he's going to want to go right along these barriers, probably in third position behind two of his teammates, and then he will open up the sprint for the line. Maybe he'll open up his account here at the Tour de France this year.
It is Flecker here, who is riding hard at the front and riding with supreme determination for his team. And it's unusual for a Spanish rider to be so good on the flat, really. 5 kilometres to go.
He's a great bike rider. We've seen a lot of him throughout this season. In fact, he's a completely changed bike rider since he came across to Fassa Bortolo. And I tell you what, Phil, at 5 kilometres to go, this is very reminiscent of the Serengeti Plains. You know, this looks like the migration of the great wildebeest.
We're going slightly faster, mind you. Running down the side now of... Oh, there's been another crash, and Seiko have got a man down now. Well, this is amazing the way this is happening. And looking at his number, this is Stefano Casagrande, who makes a return after a few years out of the Tour de France. Perhaps it's not the time to remind him of that.
I don't think it is. He's not too worried. He knows now he's inside of 5 kilometres to go. He's not got to worry about the elimination time. Just trying to fix his machine on his own. But the action and the excitement is really on the front end of the main field. Fassa Bortolo in the blue and white jerseys are very much in control. And I think they have got themselves organised to perfection. Look at that. The fourth place rider is the yellow jersey. Don't forget, he is a Fassa Bortolo rider. And then right behind, there are 4 or 5 others. Now they're keeping the tempo high, but they're also seeing a situation here where Alessio is setting up the sprint, possibly for big Magnus Backstedt.
And wouldn't that be a lovely result, especially for one Megan in South Wales? But let's see what happens here now, as Alessio are looking here. Scott Sunderland making a return to this team as well, the Australian. 1996 was the last time Scott rode the Tour de France. Since then, he's had to recover from a near-death crash in the bike races. Well, he is now in there somewhere, and his team are working very hard. But just look at the change of rhythm there as Fabian Cancellara now goes to the front as he rides yet again in support of his man, Petacchi.
Right now, he's forgotten about his yellow jersey. He's thinking about the stage win for his team leader, the man who is regarded as the fastest man in the world. He wasn't the fastest man yesterday when he only finished 8th, but Fassa Bortolo have got the organisation, which they didn't have yesterday. Cancellara is in first place. I would think it's next to be Tosato coming up. Then the last man to be just in front of the big sprinter Alessandro Petacchi will be Marco Velo, and he's the man who sets him up for the final sprint to the line.
Look at that, the maillot jaune of the Tour de France, first in the race and first on the race right now, as he just puts his head down and keeps that rhythm going, keeps the pace up, not far short of 50 kilometres. Now, goodness me, they went through the straw bales. I wasn't sure where that was. Eric Zabel.
That was Eric Zabel, and you know what he's doing? He's battling to get the wheel of the man fifth in line there, because the man fifth in line is Alessandro Petacchi. There's Hushoft as well. Everybody is moving up through this line here to try and battle for the wheel of Alessandro Petacchi. They know if they can be on that wheel, they've got a great chance of opening up the sprint.
Well, this is going to be too quick, I think, for Mario Cipollini, who's lost his lead-out man today. Don't forget, with Fanini crashing out with a broken collarbone suspected. I don't know if you saw to the right there, Paul. That was Robbie McEwen, who was waving his arms in the air. He's now moved into the heart of the field here.
Well, he was trying to get up around the outside, taking a few risks. Everybody is taking risks now. The arms are coming off the handlebars. Heads are being used to keep themselves in position. Baden Cook is right up at the front end of the main field. You can see now Kim Kirken moving up into third place. He's got the national champions jersey of Luxembourg on his shoulders, but he is well and truly a Fassa Bortolo rider.
I tell you what, the big heads of the race here have got out of the way. Lance Armstrong, Jan Ullrich, Mayo, Zubeldia, Tyler Hamilton, they're all taking a back seat now, because this is the front row in the afternoon matinee, and the man driving with tremendous speed is Cancellara. I think the legs are slowly now having to give best. Cofidis take over.
Cofidis take over, but it's still a lot of blue and white jerseys of Fassa Bortolo on the front. Kim Kirken here looking great. He's all over his bike. He knows he's got to bury himself for the next 500 metres or so, and when he swings off, he knows that one of his teammates will take up the pacemaking. This is how you lead out a big sprint. But look, you can see in about eighth position, a long way back still, Alessandro Petacchi is slightly boxed in. He's got a number of riders from Gerolsteiner moving up through the outside. Fassa Bortolo right now need to kick it up a notch.
Well, the Fassa Bortolo boys have got control, but here comes Gerolsteiner, who've got a big sprinter in Danilo Hondo. That's not Hondo who's got there yet, it'll be the helpers, but look at that sweep round to the right now, momentarily out of range. Here they come back into view now. Fassa Bortolo been split up here by the Gerolsteiner team, and Eric Zabel is still in there, the six times winner of the green jersey. Hushoff a little bit further down. This is going to be one terrific sprint.
Hushoff needs to move up right now if he's going to get himself the yellow jersey at the end of the day. Don't forget, he needs to finish in third position, but now they're kicking up to the line. There's going to be a long, sweeping left-hand bend. Alessandro Petacchi has got Eric Zabel right on his wheel, but in fact, Freddy Agricola taking over supremacy.
Well, look at this now, because Hushoff is being led here to a yellow jersey. First three will be good enough on the bonuses. The lead out now, and again, Alessandro Petacchi has been moved out of it a little bit. Hushoff is finding himself in the perfect position as they swing now towards the finish. Hushoff must kick here. This is going to be a tremendous result. And all, there's been a crash and a major pile up there as the riders go through. But keep your eyes on the front, because Robbie McEwen is taking it. McEwen always comes out best when the going gets rough. Hushoff is the new maillot jaune of the Tour de France, and McEwen in Belgium gets the result, and he leaves behind the debris.
Well, he gave warning on stage one, Robbie McEwen, and he timed it perfectly on stage two. No need for a photo. Tor Hushovd was even happier with second, and Jean-Patrick Nazon took third. For the second day running, though, Alessandro Petacchi was a disappointing eighth. With Gian Matteo Fagnini out nursing a broken collarbone, Mario Cipollini had no help in the sprint. He came in 10th as a freelance, while Lance Armstrong and the rest of the overall contenders avoided the home straight crash and finished safely in the same time as the winner. Well, he's been overshadowed by Alessandro Petacchi for most of the season, but Robbie McEwen was timed today at 66 kilometres an hour coming across the line. Ned Bolting caught up with him at the bottom of the podium steps.
Second yesterday and a stage winner today, it's all working out beautifully for you, isn't it?
Yeah, yesterday I was a bit disappointed because I felt really great in the sprint, but I ran out of road to be able to catch Kusipu. Today I started fairly early, and yeah, if you're not feeling really good, you don't win from that distance. I think I hit the front at 250 to go, but you know, I felt great and I was able to go all the way through to the line, and to get one in a stage win, you know, in the first 2 days is great. Takes pressure off now.
And you had special reasons to dedicate that stage win today as well.
Yeah, true. An ex-teammate of mine, Steve Vermont, he unfortunately passed away last week and was buried today. For him and his family. And also for my teammate and roommate, who Nick Gates, who couldn't start today because he injured himself yesterday.
So a great day for Robbie McEwen, but as far as the standings go, second place was more important today. Tor Hushoff took it, and the 12-second bonus that comes with it was enough for him to leapfrog Fabian Cancellara and take first place. Cancellara, who did his bit at the front, delivering Petacchi to the finish, is now second, and two good days for Robbie McEwen move him up to third and Lance Armstrong down into fourth. By the way, riders can't lose time for crashes inside the final kilometre of the race, so Kurt Asle Arvesen keeps his 15th place, and all the other big names are where they were in relation to each other. So Tor Hushovd is the second yellow jersey of the 2004 race, the first Norwegian, as well as the first man named Tor, I believe, to lead the Tour. However, he almost didn't make it to the finish, involved in that crash with Frederik Bessie.
Like 15k to go, I had somebody touch my bike and the bike broke down, so I had to change it. And the whole team went back to get me back on, and that was so hard. I was I was already then like tired, but last 5K I recovered and Julian Dindi that perfectly laid out, took me up to the perfect position 200 meters to go.
At that stage you must have thought it would have been tough to end up in the yellow jersey.
Yeah, after I had a problem 15K to go, I said, oh, I think it would be hard to like be top three, but I'm in good shape, I've got a lot of power, and now I show I took my 12 seconds and now I'm in yellow.
This is the infamous pavé, the cobblestones of northern France, and tackling them on a road bike is like trying to pedal a pneumatic drill. The big difference being that at least with a pneumatic drill, you're the one inflicting damage on the road. This terrain forms part of Paris-Roubaix, perhaps the most famous one-day race in the cycling calendar. So for the tour organisers, it's simply a matter of paying their respects. To them, each one of these cobbles is a unique piece of cycling history. To the riders, though, they all look the same, like a trip to casualty.
In fact, there were only 4 kilometres worth of cobbles on the 210-kilometre stage, split into two sections. But everyone knows the kind of carnage Paris-Roubaix regularly produces, and the bunch was extremely nervous approaching the first stretch of pavé, all trying to get to the front where it was safest.
There is a lot of work being done here now as they try to defend the front of the peloton. Just look at that long line, and there's been a crash. There is another pile-up again at
number?
The back.
That's
and
not...
that, in fact, is Noval, who was moments ago driving the charge.
I saw that number, and all of a sudden I thought it was a number one. It looked very much like number one, but it is Benjamin Noval. This is the kind of accident that can happen, and this accident must have happened pretty close up to the front end of the main field. This is Iban Mayo, who's gone down, number 31. Now, this is a very important moment. We had said that the cobblestone sections and the run-up to the cobblestones was very dangerous. Iban Mayo does not have any teammates around him as we speak, and in fact, two or three of his teammates went down in that incident. He's going to have a major battle right now to get himself up to the rear end of the main field.
While the tour doctors dealt with the aftermath of the crash, the front of the field was already on the cobbles, with Lance Armstrong protected by a full retinue of US postal workers. Behind them, Euskaltel had regrouped to try to pace the bruised and bloody Mayo back into the race. Tor Hushov, the yellow jersey, was in the same group, but the gap was widening, not coming down, which meant there was going to be a new race leader at the finish. The most likely candidates were the men who started the day second and third, Fabien Cancellara and the Tour's in-form sprinter, Robbie McEwen.
Remember, the winner gets a 20-second bonus, second gets 12 seconds, third gets 8 seconds. And at this stage of the Tour de France, it could produce almost one of 7 or 8 riders as the new leader of the Tour. Just hope we get it right when we come to the finish. But Robbie McEwen, who's never worn the yellow jersey, and only 3 Australians ever had, by the way, Phil Anderson, Stuart O'Grady and Brad McGee. And I know that Robbie would like to join that rather salubrious group of Aussies.
He certainly would. He's in fine sprinting form. The acceleration he got yesterday surprised one or two of his competitors, including one by the name of Alessandro Pataki, who said, I wanted to get onto McEwen's wheel, but he came past me so fast there was absolutely nothing I could do. And when I saw that he'd got the gap, I basically gave up because I knew I wasn't going to win. This is the group of the yellow jersey. Tor Hushov, the yellow jersey for a day. He started the day with an 8-second advantage over Cancellara, a 17-second advantage over Robbie McEwen, and 18 over Lance Armstrong, but that has all completely changed right now.
Well, looking down there at a very select group, Alessandro Pataki obviously feels confident now as he's got his team working again on the front. This is going to be a sprint royale, even though we split the field, because some of the best sprinters are still here. I'm not too sure Baden Cook's made it. I think he must have been left back.
Baden Cook, I haven't seen him. I think he might have had an incident earlier on at the rear end of the event, but certainly Cancellara is looking to see if he can help his own teammate out to get himself the win. Cancellara will hope that Robbie McEwen doesn't get into the top three, because if Robbie McEwen does not make top three on the stage, then Fabien Cancellara, the first wearer of the yellow jersey, will get himself the yellow jersey back again. But there's a lot of confusion. There are a lot of riders in this group here, Phil, from Fassa Bortolo, nice and organized. Don't discount Jan Ullrich having a go to try and lead out Eric Zabel, because Zabel is just bobbing around in and out there with the pink and white jersey of T-Mobile.
And there's always also the possibility that Mark Scanlon could win this. He packs a good sprint, although he'll feel his job perhaps is to lead out Jean-Patrick Nazon, who is still the team's number one sprinter in this race. He won in Paris last year. and was right up amongst the placings yesterday, so he's warming up now. The pressure is going on here as they try to take control for Pataki, but Lotto have a man in second place.
This is a dodgy part of the course here. They don't come into the nice long straightaway until 1.5 kilometers to go. They're going through a nice little neighborhood, but unfortunately there are three or four very difficult corners that they have to negotiate. Fassa Bortolo keeping the pace nice and high. They're trying to keep their man Asla Alessandro Pataki at the front end of the main field. Danilo Hondo could be a serious contender for the win this afternoon. A couple of years ago, we remember, he won three stages of the Giro d'Italia. We thought he was going to be the new sprinter on the block.
Well, this is the difficult part of the race today now, but they're going so quick. They've pulled it into a long, thin line, which will eliminate some of the dangers around the back streets here. Right. As we run through the suburbs of Vascal, this is really a very nice residential area. Although the neighbours have had to move the cars off the road today for the arrival of the Tour de France. 2 kilometres from the finish now. The big sprinters are still here. Robbie McEwen is here. Danilo Hondro, Jean-Patrick Nazon, and of course Alessandro Pataki, who's looking for revenge today.
The team that's got the biggest organization, though, is Gerald Steiner in the pale blue jerseys there. They're looking over their shoulders to see the position of Danilo Hondo. Jean-Patrick Nazon is not too far away. He won the final stage of the Tour de France last year, if you remember, on the Champs-Élysées, the one that all the sprinters want to see. Now they're at 1.5 kilometers to go. It is straightening up. Robbie McEwen is a long way back.
Miles.
Too far back, I think, for the moment. He's going to panic. But Robbie is a clever bike rider. He'll wait for a slight slowing at the front end of the main field and take advantage of that to catapult himself up into the top five.
Well, he is an awful long way back. If he wins this, it would not surprise us. He's a very talented bike rider. There he is there, the green jersey, sitting on the back wheel, I think, of Voeckler there, probably Kim Kirken, actually, a Luxembourg champion, similar colours to the champions of France and Holland. But Kim Kirken it is, and in fact McEwen has got his wheel. Now, the big lead out, though, is coming for Danilo Hondo here, the third wheel of those three boys. A little bit of an early swing over because Hondo's being left now, and Jean-Patrick Nazon and Mark Scanlon are both moving up here now. This is going to be a tight sprint, and Robbie still is not in the frame as they line up for the finish now. Hondo gets the big lead out. This could be a great win for the German if it happens. Jean-Patrick Nazon digs on the left of our picture now. Now Hondo goes here. Hondo launches for the line, but there's a big fan. Robbie McEwen, no way through, or is there? Oh, it's a shame the cars come in the front view here, because there's McEwen off to the right now as we try to look over the top of the car. McEwen is digging in, and if he hits the line first, and I think he's going to, he's got tremendous power. McEwen on the line, though. I think that's Jean-Patrick Nazon who has taken it on the line. That is a great result. McEwen maybe third or fourth, and I don't think that's good enough, but we'll have to see how the maths work out on that one as to who leads the Tour. But the winner is Nazon.
The winner was Jean-Patrick Nazon, making the first stage finish in France a home win ahead of Eric Zabel. But more importantly for the race overall, Robbie McEwen took third, and the all-important 8-second bonus that went with it. Lance Armstrong's group was just behind them. Nearly 4 minutes had passed by the time Iban Mayo struggled in, facing the prospect that his Tour challenge might be over just 4 days into the race. Robbie McEwen's Tour, though, was getting better by the day. He'd finished second, first and third on consecutive days, and the bonuses he picked up along the way were enough to put him into the race lead by a second ahead of Fabian Cancellara. The leading big name was still the biggest of all, Lance Armstrong in fifth, and the time gaps to his major rivals were starting to open up. Closest to him were two Americans, Rabobank's Levi Leipheimer and a rejuvenated Bobby Julich riding for CSC, both within 10 seconds. Jan Ullrich was another 5 seconds behind them, just ahead of Tyler Hamilton. The climbers Francisco Mancebo and Roberto Heras were over half a minute down, but the big loser was Iban Mayo, who in the space of a stage had slipped to 101st place, 4 minutes and 7 seconds behind the man he beat in a warm-up race for the Tour just last month. Robbie McEwen, by the way, did double duty on the podium, taking the green jersey as leader of the points competition, as well as the yellow of race leader.
Let's have a look at one or two emails. This is one we've had from a lot of you. Alan Hughes in Exeter and Alex McGibbon will give you credit. If it is an unwritten rule in cycling, you don't attack when there has been a crash. Why did the peloton not wait for Iban Mayo? The US postal team seemed to increase the pace at the front. Well, first of all, I don't think the US Postal Team were attacking Mayo at all. They knew the cobblestones were coming and the strongest men got to the front because they knew there would be a lot of crashes behind. They weren't attacking any particular rider on this situation at all. They just wanted to make sure they were safe. I don't think you can expect anybody to wait in that situation, Paul.
I think everyone was very nervous about the cobblestones. I don't think they accelerated the pace. They certainly didn't wait for Iban Mayo after the cobblestones. But let's not forget there was another cobblestone section coming up a little further up the road. And I think that's why the speed of the main field just kept up. And they, at the end of the day, Euskaltel, Euskadi were not strong enough to bring Mayo back into the race.
That's true. It's true the Spanish riders don't really like riding on these particular roads. And if you get yourself in the wrong position in the peloton, the chances are you will fall. I don't think it was any case of a rider attacking another rider. It was simply a case of every man riding for himself on that particular day. Graham Lang in Plymouth, as someone who's just turned 40, I would be interested to know the age of the oldest rider ever to complete the race. Well, indeed, we're not absolutely certain who is the oldest rider to actually finish the tour, but we can certainly tell you there are a number of riders at your age, Graham, who have ridden extremely well in this race. The oldest winner, by the way, is Fermin Lambo in 1922. He was a mere 36, just a youngster. Eugene Christophe, Joop Zoetemelk, Raymond Poulidor, Joachim Agostino, they all completed the tour when they were 40 years of age. That must have been fantastic for them. David Murphy from Glasgow, this is one for you, Paul. Why do they have feeding stations when you can get replenished from team cars throughout the race?
Well, in fact, the reason is, I think, that out on the course, the reason to have a feeding station is so that it takes away the chaos of all the riders in the field going back to the team cars to take on board food and drinks. If that was to happen, there'd be a constant movement of riders going back to the team cars all of the time, and it would be very precarious. The reason they changed the rules to allow riders to go back to the team car to take on board drinks and food is basically because of safety. In the old days, riders were only allowed to take drinks at the start and at one point during the race. But because of the fact that physiologically we've understood a lot more about athletes' bodies, and we know now they need to take on 3, 4, and even 5 litres of drinks during the course of a race, that they've made the rules just that little bit more flexible.
They certainly spend a lot of time back at those cars when the sun comes out. Let's hope it isn't too long before it does and gets warmer. Moving on, our last question, and Mike Beer from Liverpool. Is there a wet weather tyre?
Well, yes, there is. In the 1980s, when I was racing and when I went to the UK to race in the city centre races, they had a tyre specifically for wet weather conditions, and I thought it was very good. It's never really been adopted in races like the Tour de France because the rubber compound was so sticky, it felt as if it was sticking to the road once the weather started to dry out, and it's impossible, really, to have riders start on a wet weather tyre and change halfway through the race like the Tour de France just because it's not structured the same way as a Formula One event, for example.
And remember, the tyres at the moment are blown up very hard, and that's probably why some riders are falling in the wet, often 4 times the pressure of a car tyre. Let's go back to the action.
Now, it's a funny event, the team time trial, sort of a cycling equivalent of tax breaks for the rich, whereby a big star on a strong team can gain significant advantage over a talented challenger who can't quite afford the same supporting cast. In 2003, for example, Lance Armstrong won the Tour over Jan Ullrich by 61 seconds, and 43 of those came from the team time trial. His advantage over Iban Mayo in this event was closer to 3.5 minutes. Now, to their credit, the Tour organisers have recognised this problem, but instead of having the gumption to simply drop the team time trial, as they did for a few years in the 90s, they've introduced rule changes to limit the amount of time each team can lose on the stage. That is to say, they're loath to lose the colourful spectacle of 9 men riding in formation in skin suits, but they'd rather it didn't have too much effect on the outcome of the race. Here's Nev Bolting to explain.
Race management and concentration of the stewards. Well, just when you thought the rules governing the team time trial were complicated enough, watch out, they've just got a whole lot more complicated. Now, pay attention, the gentleman will say this only once.
The new rule, very important for rider. Because it's not obligation and then finish on the winter, the delay is very, very long. Yeah. Now it's possible, the new rule is finished, it's on the top, it's 3 minutes. Between two teams, if possible, 20 seconds. For example, the first team, time is zero, the second team, 50 seconds. 15 seconds, it's possible to time in the classical general is 15 seconds.
So basically what that means is that if, like Lotto Domo, who lost 4 minutes 53 seconds on the team time trial last year, you're frankly no good at it, then why bother putting any effort in at all? The worst that's going to happen to you is you're going to lose 3 minutes. Big deal.
In fact, there is a little more to it than that. The most time the second place team can now lose is set at 20 seconds. The third place can lose no more than 30 seconds, and so on, all the way down to that maximum 21st place time limit of 3 minutes. The confusion is so abundant that not even the riders themselves have fully digested the facts.
Teams like our team, we spent a lot of effort, a lot of time, a lot of money, a lot of equipment to build a team that can go fast in climbs and on the flat. And, you know, we really put in a big effort to make our team trial working good. And now it's all limited. I mean, nobody really seriously is talking about having a 2 minute 30 limit on LPS time trial. I would like that. Why is that? No, you know, the climbers, they cannot lose time in a team time trial. But us, the big and heavy guys, we lose 6 minutes, 8 minutes on a time trial on LPS. So we should then have 2 minutes 30 on both time trials. Or just forget about it.
The upshot of it all is that once more in the Tour's long history of tampering with the rules, uncertainty and possibly amused bafflement will be widespread. Sit back and enjoy the show.
Which is more than the riders could. This shot shows you just how fortunate they were that there was no rain on the cobbles on stage three. No such luck on this stage though, and the early teams were all having trouble in the driving rain. Race leader Robbie McEwen wasn't out of trouble even after he'd finished. On the way back to the team bus, he had the indignity of being attacked by souvenir hunters, or possibly very young eBay merchants, who were after his bottle. Well, Robbie's quick to lose his at the best of times and gave them a lesson in manners by taking it back off the chief culprit and handing it to a more respectful young fan in front of him. Not so sure about the English lesson he gave them, though. The best early time was set by the Spanish squad, Ilas Baleares, who came in with a time of 1 hour, 13 minutes and 18 seconds. With the teams going out in reverse order of their rankings in the team competition, US Postal were last to start. At the first time check, after 19 kilometres though, they were only fifth fastest. And their Tour novice, Benjamin Noval, had dropped off the back, leaving 8 men to take their turns at the front. By the time they hit the second time check, the weather had improved substantially and so had they. Through the 41.8-kilometre point, they had the best split time, 28 seconds faster than the leaders in the clubhouse, Ilas Baleares. As we pick up commentary, the next team to finish will be Jan Ullrich's T-Mobile.
So, as T-Mobile come up now, it's 1:12:55 and counting.
It's going to be a very fast time here for these riders as they come to the line. Now then, this is the time that they've got to beat, 1:13:18. They've got to go around these corners very quickly. T-Mobile are not going to do it. They will not get it there this time, but they will go very close indeed.
Well, this is an incredible sprint for the line. They've just slipped behind Baleares as they come up to the line, but they're in second place, 1:13:22 for T-Mobile. They really did pull that one out of the bag.
Tyler Hamilton's team here, still looking strong, but they're down now to 5 riders. I cannot believe this. This is bad. This is panic on the streets of London, or should I say panic on the streets of northern France.
Well, you say it's panic, Paul, but their time is improving since they've lost their men. They've gone through in second place. What they've done now is throw out all their cards. They can't lose anybody else, otherwise they've got to stop and wait.
The Team CSC are catching a couple of riders who were dropped from Team Phonak a little earlier. That's Santiago Perez, who's being caught there, and Nicolas Jalabert. And they will just try and ride to the finish now and make sure that they don't get eliminated. But Team CSC are doing a fabulous job here. They were well down in the 15th place at the first time check, and they're pulling themselves up now into the top 5.
There's the times of the leader at the bottom, 1:13:18.
It'll be a big call, but I think it's just possible. This, as they come up the rise and make the left turn onto the cobblestones, they could snick it by a couple of seconds. They're going to have to put a bit of a sprint in, but what a turn up. The problems this team has had on the road and to produce this ride, this has been absolutely remarkable. And as they come to the line, the clock will give them best time. 1:13:10, incredible.
That is unbelievable. This team has had five riders for the last 15 kilometres. The majority of the work must have been done in there by Tyler Hamilton. There is Oscar Sevilla, babyface they call him. He's looked like a 15-year-old for the last 10 years, but he's a man that Tyler Hamilton can really count upon in the big mountains. This is a huge bonus this afternoon for Tyler Hamilton and Team Phonak. Let's not forget, first participation in the Tour de France for this team, which is why Hamilton switched across.
It looks like settling the fourth, Bobby Wise is saying, just take it easy. We're not going to worry about second on these cobbles. As they swing into the home straight, nobody's going to fall. They cruise to the line here. Do they hold fourth? It's going to be close, I think, because they were fifth at the last check, and they've just got about enough time to get to the line here for fourth. And that, after all their trouble, simply brilliant. 1:13:49, fourth at the moment.
Absolutely magical performance. Just to remind ourselves, Phil, at the first time check, Team CSC was 12th place, 58 seconds down off the leaders. They have done one of the performances of the event. When you add in all of the mishaps and misfortunes they've had out on the course, this has been a great ride by this team.
Absolutely outstanding. The face there, the study of Bobby Julich, who is refining himself. Once a third place finisher, let us never forget that, in the Tour de France in 1998. Well, there are two teams left. One we've never seen at all, Faso Bortolo, but they're not featuring at all. But I can now tell you that US Postal at the third check is through 1:08 ahead of Ilis Belliris and clearly in the lead.
Wow, that is unbelievable. 1:08 at 56.8 kilometres covered.
Here comes Faso Bortolo. They're nowhere in the hunt at any of the time checks. Life has not improved for them. They're not interested in the overall classification. They're hoping that Alessandro Bataki will find his sprinting legs very shortly and start winning stages for them. Ninth at 1:14:55. Here they come. No need to worry. The big commander-in-chief, George Hincapie, brings them around the corner. It is a magnificent time as they race up towards the line. Hincapie, Paul, he should play poker for a living. Look at that face. Please. And look at Armstrong, too. Into second place now. The first five get the time. They all will get the same time. Lance Armstrong is back where he's been for 5 years. The leader of the Tour de France.
In the yellow jersey. Hincapie enjoying the victory. Look at his face now. Lance coming to the front. Look at that smile. It's
incredible.
As wide as the Pacific Ocean as he crosses the line. The fastest time of the day, 1:12:03, 53 kilometres an hour. Thank you very much. Look at that smile. Superb.
I tell you, Paul, the team
did this.
There were moments early on I thought the crowd had gone home, but can you hear them now? This is the most popular man in France as well. You read so many things against him in the press. Sometimes the journalists should go out and speak to the public.
All smiles and high, low and medium fives among the eight US postal finishers. But Lance was already dried off and addressing the world on television by the time the ninth came in. Benjamin Noval, the Tour rookie, rolled home 13 minutes late for the celebrations. It was a great team day, though, for US Postal, albeit not as great as it would have been last year. Have a look at the two columns of times here. The first one shows the real time gaps between US Postal and the teams behind them. The second shows the adjusted times using the new limits for every place in the pecking order. So despite beating Phonak into second place by 1:07, US Postal's official winning margin was only 20 seconds. Last year, Armstrong would have gained 1:19 on Jan Ullrich of T-Mobile. This year, it's barely half that at 40 seconds. And it's the same all the way down the line to Euskaltel in eighth place, who effectively get 1:15 back on their real deficit, cut from 2:35 to 1:20. The one fact of the day not open to reinterpretation by calculator was that Lance Armstrong took over as race leader, although even that was a byproduct of the stage win rather than the main objective. At this point, having the race lead isn't something he's going to want to waste precious energy defending. Now, the team time trial always gives the general classification a top heavy look, and this year it was no different. The top five places all occupied by US Postal, with Jose Enrique Gutierrez and Tyler Hamilton of Phonak the only outsiders in the top eight. And here's how Armstrong stacked up now against his rivals for the race overall after that result. Hamilton was the closest serious contender, 36 seconds in arrears. Jan Ullrich now 55 seconds back. Bobby Julich, Francisco Manthebo and Levi Leipheimer were all grouped around the minute mark. Then there was Roberto Heras at a minute 45 and Iban Mayo nearly 5.5 minutes behind the leader. So the first yellow jersey of the race for Lance, the first souvenir cuddly toy of her tour career for Sheryl Crow, and the first and who knows possibly last experiment with adjusted timings for the team time trial event.
Now, you may have noticed on this year's Tour de France coverage these little yellow boxes fitted to the back of every single bike. These things are transponders, and at the finishing line, you can see here a long electromagnetic loop, the width of the racing track. Now, as these transponders pass through the loop, every single individual bike is registered. Don't be fooled by the fact that they appear to be behind the real finishing line. That's because they're fitted to the back of the bike, exactly 1.20 meters from the leading edge of the front wheel, so that when they pass through here, that means the bike itself is finishing the race. Now, what they do with that information is another story altogether. Right, this is the readout from the transponders at the end of stage one. Here they all are. Instantaneous, highly accurate, but still unofficial timings. The official timings are still done in the traditional way here using the finishing line camera. You can see Jan Kersipu crossing the line just ahead of Robbie McEwen. What these offer, however, is an instant, very accurate cross-referencing. For example, here you can see this rider. You can't quite make out the number on his back, and although we probably know who it is, confirmation is given straight away here, because we know from his transponder crossing the line that Tor Hushovd was indeed in third place. It's that sort of very accurate readout that these transponders offer the Tor.
When groups of riders bunched together cross the line, they all receive the same finishing time as the first in the group to finish. But where one group stops and another one begins has always been a point of vagueness for the officials. This technology removes any room for doubt, defining the groups instantly and precisely. And it's not just at the finishing line that they record these timings. 1 kilometre out, the Flamme Rouge has a similar loop, and if this system is adopted officially, so will every intermediate sprint and mountain prize.
So just a little footnote to that. On the final intermediate sprint of stage one, after the riders had crossed the line, there was chaos for fully 20 minutes while the organisers tried to work out just who had crossed ahead of who. Now, when I quizzed these guys about why it had taken so long to get that information out, they had one very simple explanation. They hadn't fitted a magnetic loop. This is, after all, a trial. It's new technology. But it is precisely that sort of problem that it's designed to sort out.
Now, as much as he was happy to win the team time trial and open up gaps on his major rivals, Lance Armstrong wouldn't have been too thrilled to be wearing the yellow jersey. To other riders, it would be a career highlight. To Lance, at least at this stage, it was almost more trouble than it was worth. For one thing, all the other squads looked to the leader's team to control the race, and trying to defend the jersey means chasing down every madcap attack that goes off the front. Lance would have preferred to be back in the bunch in civilian clothes, keeping himself and his team fresh for the mountains, where the next big showdown with his rivals was going to come. So if anybody fancied taking the jersey on stage five, they were welcome to come and have a go if they thought they were hard enough.
And a long stage after a tough team time trial is the perfect opportunity to get a jump on a tired peloton. Stage 5 was 200 kilometres from Amiens to Chartres. It was another difficult day on the road, windy and rainy and littered with crashes. Brad McGee didn't actually go down in any of them, but he did get off. FDJour.com's Australian rider had been suffering all week with a bad back and finally conceded that it wasn't going to get any better on a 3,400 kilometre bike ride. As we join commentary, the inevitable breakaway is out front, and there are some good riders in it. The Australian Stuart O'Grady, Sweden's Magnus Backsted, Jakob Pihl of Denmark, who's been in just about every break since the tour began, and two Frenchmen, Sandy Cazar and Thomas Voeckler, riding in the colours of the French national champion. And Voeckler is the highest placed man in the classification, 3 minutes behind Lance Armstrong. So if the break stays away, he will be the new leader of the race.
They're all starting to look back now. O'Grady's in an ideal position. He's going to force Jakob Pihl to lead out the sprint.
1,000 metres to go. It's a long way. The two others are just about to make contact.
There
Sandy
we
Kassar
come.
Comes back.
Now, if I was one of those, I'd have gone straight for it and I wouldn't have wasted time. But there he goes again. And Peel again grits his teeth. All five men at 900 metres are back. Maggie just hasn't got it. He's going to be fifth.
Maggie's on the rivet here this afternoon, but it's now four riders. Voeckler very nervous. He's used a lot of energy to attack here. Jakob Peel in second position, trying to get some breath into his body for the final explosion up to the line. Sandy Kassar has been very clever. If he's got anything left in those legs now, he needs to launch the counter-attack. O'Grady looking over his shoulder, waiting to see if Maggie Backstead is going to come back. Very nervous. They're losing big time now. O'Grady moves up into first place. If he opens the sprint, Maggie's going for it. He's got not much left in his body, but it's one last little attempt.
O'Grady takes a look at Maggie. He wanted somebody in front. He needed a win. He's got the biggest man in the race to hide behind now. This could be a perfect finish. Stuart O'Grady is the pure man. It's a track finish, this. He's the ace rider on the track. He's won medals there at every colour, Commonwealth and World Championships. Now goes Sandy Kassar. Is he going to upset it? Now comes O'Grady on the inside. O'Grady grits his teeth, takes on Kassar. Nobody will beat O'Grady in a finish like this. The Australian remembers 1998, takes it on the line. Peel is second, Kassar is third. The Mayo jaune of the Tour de France, Voeckler is fourth, and Backstead finishes fifth.
Well, 12 and a half minutes later, the main field arrived, and there was another sprint to pick up the bonus points for sixth place. Robbie McEwen, the leader of the green jersey points competition, nabbed them ahead of Yannick Tombach and Tor Hushovd. And there's confirmation of the results. O'Grady winning the stage, but fourth place more than enough for Thomas Voeckler to take the yellow jersey, with the group containing Lance Armstrong and all the other leading contenders coming in 12 minutes 33 seconds down. First man on the podium, though, was the stage winner, Stuart O'Grady's second win in the Tour, 6 years after his first in Grenoble.
Stuart, many congratulations. That was quite a stage and pretty extraordinary conditions as well.
Hard conditions, very, very hard. That really sucked.
You didn't enjoy it?
No, not really. I mean, you enjoy it because you're out there, and definitely enjoy it now because I've won. But yeah, I mean, it's just a hard slog. It's just a big psychological battle, you know. You're always looking around to see if the other guys are hurting. The blockhead wind, the rain never eased up. That was just a hard day.
Well, the Stage 5 result changed the general classification beyond all recognition. While Lance took a day's holiday, that five-man gang had broken into the top of the standings and established squatters' rights. Thomas Voeckler in particular looked as though he was going to prove difficult to shift, with a lead of 3 minutes over the second-place man O'Grady and 9.5 on Armstrong, who'd slipped to sixth. There were no changes in the time gaps between him and his challengers for overall victory, although, of course, everybody had been bumped back down the order by the five-man break. Well, it was common knowledge that the yellow jersey was up for grabs for anyone who got into the right break on Stage 5. Thomas Voeckler took advantage of it, and that's why he was the new race leader.
Time for the emails, and first one here from Brian in Liverpool. Why do all the riders get the same finishing time when they cross the line in one big group? Those at the front are up to 20 seconds or more ahead of the ones at the back. Well, you're quite right, Brian. But, you know, can you imagine on the narrow roads when the riders are sprinting for the finish, if the boys at the back try to be the boys at the front, it would be absolute carnage. So it makes sense if you finish alongside one another, you are given the same time. And it really is up to the referees of the day. If there is a measurable gap and daylight between the groups, say of a second or more, they will get a separate time. Ian Forkes, could you please settle an argument? I say that helmets are now compulsory, but my son says that it is up to the teams as to whether they should be worn. Paul?
Well, Ian, you're right. In fact, it is compulsory in all professional racing for riders to wear helmets. But there is one exception to the rule. If they come to a mountaintop finish, and a mountaintop finish that is more than 5 kilometres in length, they're allowed to take the helmets off for the final climb of the day.
Right. The final question today, Rudolf Morrison says, join the interviews at the end of your programme. Can you get the woman to stand out of camera shot, as she is not important to the content and a big distraction? Well, I'll tell you what, indeed, Rudolf, that is Marilyn Klesch, and she is the head of broadcasting, and in fact, if it wasn't for her, we probably wouldn't get access to the riders themselves, because she makes sure they come to our camera. However, she has promised me that she will, in fact, never get in the way of the camera again, and I'm sure she's telling the truth. Now back to the action.
Stage 6 took the race down into the Loire Valley, 196 kilometres from Bonval to Angers. The two big Italian sprinters in the race were already heading home, Alessandro Petacchi and Mario Cipollini abandoning without a stage win between them. Well, the weather was improving, but the road safety statistics weren't. Lance Armstrong came down in an early crash, and as part of their contractual obligations, a couple of teammates fell off with him. He was soon back on the bike, though, and back in the race.
This is going to be the most difficult finish we've had for the sprinters in the Tour de France so far. Why? Because at 600 metres to go, it climbs up all the way to the finish line. It's made just that little bit more difficult to judge as well by the fact that just here, with around about 400 metres to go, there's a very nasty bend around to the finish. The riders trying to win this will hug the corner there and come around and hope to see the finish line in front of them. But unlucky, it's not there. It's a further 200 metres up the road around the final bend. If you want to win this sprint, you have to wait until the last possible moment to open up the gallop. A man who's got the experience to do that, I feel, could very well be Eric Zabel, the man who on six occasions has won the green jersey. He'd like to open up his account at the Tour de France this year with a win right here in Angers.
As we join commentary, Spain's Juan Antonio Fletcher is out front on his own, trying to win with a solo escape for the second year running. But the pack is bearing down on him fast as he powers towards the finish.
4 kilometres to go. The pink and white jerseys on the front of T-Mobile. They'll be thinking about Eric Zabel. Now, what kind of a lead out would that be if Jan Ullrich came to the front to lead out his old mate Eric Zabel? Because I think this is a good finish for Zabel. And in the past, we've seen Ullrich actually lead Zabel out to a finish like this in the outskirts of Liège.
Well, what kind of a win would this be if Fletcher survives? Because inside 4 kilometres to go, he has still got 18 seconds over the field. They're not pulling him back right now, and unless they reorganise, and they haven't been very well organised at all so far, because he is holding them, and he's riding so strongly. Remember, he will respond to the cheers here. These people know what they're watching, they'll know who's in the lead, and they will shout him on. The French love a winner, and this is a runaway just now by Juan Antonio Fletcher of Spain, who rides for Antonio. Now, trouble at the back there. That looks as though Decker has sat up and slipped off the back.
Flat tyre for Eric Decker, but it's not a problem for him now. He just cruises into the finish. He will not make contact with the main field again here this afternoon because there is such a lot of pressure on the front end of the main field. It is 13 seconds advantage for Juan Antonio Fletcher at 3 kilometres to go to the finish. That's around about 3.5 minutes of effort he has to keep going on. It's going to be very difficult for him on the last 600 metres, but it looks as if he's got the strength in those thighs of his still ticking over.
They have not been able to reorganise. Remember, they're preoccupied now. They've got to look for their sprinters, the men they've tried to shut this race down for, and put them in position to win the sprint, while at the same time they've got to continue the chase. Just inside 2 miles from the finish now, and this is a wonderful ride by Fletcher, whichever way it goes. They are coming back. It's 13 seconds, they're saying now. He just got to keep on trying and hoping. The only disadvantage, it is slightly, ever so slightly uphill, and those legs surely will complain.
Down again, 10 seconds this time. Slowly but surely they're eating into this man's advantage. He looks good. I think the whole of Spain is on his shoulders, egging him on to try and get himself the victory. Another second disappearing right now as he sees the banner indicating 2 kilometres to go. Stefano Zanini on the front. Look at the organisation on the left-hand side there. Stuart O'Grady's team moving forward as well. Jimmy Casper, I think, this afternoon going to try and repay the favour to Stuart O'Grady and get him to the front in an ideal position.
Well, he continues now without looking over his shoulder. He knows exactly what's going on behind him. He's looking, though, for the 2 kilometre banner. It's just around this corner. There is still a very good chance here for Fletcher. Zabel's men, as they are at the moment, T-Mobile, are being sent to the front to try and put Zabel in a position to win. There is the gap now. You have to feel sorry for Juan Antonio Fletcher. That's all he's got left after a breakaway of 170-plus kilometres. 5 solitary seconds, and they're about to gobble him up.
The eagle has landed. I think the vultures are in the trees now, ready to pounce on that lone man at the front. He has been pulled back into the fold for a crazy moment there. I thought he was going to survive. He sat up right now inside of the last kilometre. He's being caught. Now look at the movement on the right-hand side. You can see riders now trying to set the sprint up for everybody. I think there's been a crash in the final kilometre as well. One or two riders have gone down. I can't see the yellow jersey. This is what's happened. This is at the yellow, the red kite. 1 kilometre to go. They'll be given the same time.
Well, it's very, very close. If that is the kite, there'll be a big argument as to whether they get the same time or not. Some of those boys aren't the right side of the kite, but we don't know where Lance Armstrong is. He's not here, that's for sure. We think they'll all be given the same time, but let's get back to the action at the front here now. Zabel is right there in the pink jersey trying to break in here, but I'm not sure. That looks like Scarpone trying to have a little bit of a dig in second place. Zabel, this is the sweep up the hill here now. No sign at all of Robbie McEwen this time out either. Tom Bowman in second place, and boxed in there was in fact Jean-Patrick Nazon. Bowman is in the perfect position here to take this one. Now he digs in, the quick step driver. This is the win he has wanted, and he's not going to relinquish this. Tom Bowman gets his first victory in the Tour de France as he hits the line, right on the line. Stuart O'Grady, Paul Sherwin's tip, has got second.
Good ride by O'Grady. He recovered overnight, but there's absolute carnage at the back. We're looking to see where the leaders of the Tour de France are. Here's Hincapie, and there is Armstrong right behind him. Armstrong is in second place. I should think there is Oscar Sevilla as well, but this accident happened right underneath the 1 kilometre to go banner, so we should all have exactly the same time at the end of the day. I haven't seen Tyler Hamilton, I haven't seen Jan Ullrich come up to the line, but I think fortunately that accident happened, Phil, at 1 kilometre to go exactly. Oscar Sevilla went down there. He's just looking at his hip. He must have gone down quite heavily. Let's have a look. There is Floyd Landis coming up through the finishing line. We're looking for a pink jersey. There's the yellow jersey of Thomas Voeckler. But as you can see, that accident was right plumb beneath the red kite of the last kilometer.
Tom Bonan left US Post also that he could be free to ride for himself instead of Lance Armstrong. And he did that brilliantly here, rocking the bike like Eric Zabel in the final meters, and beating the old master at his own uphill strongman's game to take a superb first stage win that promises many more. Stuart O'Grady came in ahead of Zabel too and picked up some valuable green jersey points in the process. Behind the sprint, though, it was chaos. Riders all over the road at the 1 kilometre banner. But it was the 1 kilometre banner that saved them all losing time, because according to race rules, any rider who crashes in the final kilometre of a stage is given the same time as the main field. The irony being that that particular rule is there precisely to discourage people taking unnecessary risks in the run-in. But that was no consolation to Robbie McEwen. The crash didn't cost him any time, but it stopped him sprinting for the points places, which meant Stuart O'Grady's second place was enough to deprive McEwen of the green jersey by 2 points. In the end, though, all the day's drama did absolutely nothing to the overall standings. The Stage 5 SKPs still held the top 5 spots, ahead of Lance Armstrong 9.5 minutes back in 6th, and the time gaps from the defending champion to his challengers stayed the same all the way down the line. Armstrong, though, was unimpressed at what he perceived to be the cause of yet another crash.
Coming in, they got the barriers really tight, and you've got 200 guys raging through there at 40 miles an hour. I don't know what the hell they're thinking. I mean, you're going to have crashes. And we were fortunate that that crash was literally 10 meters inside the 1K barrier, our banner. Otherwise, you know, we would have been docked half a minute. And it's just, anyways.
All right.
Good. Bad luck and good luck.
All right.
And look at this. Chris Boorman is down. The time trial has hardly started. The Tour de France has hardly begun. And I think Boorman could be out of it already.
It was 1995 when Chris Boorman crashed out of the prologue so spectacularly, and it happened in the finish town for Stage 7, Saint-Brieuc. Not a good omen for a race in which road accidents were threatening to decide the fate of the leading contenders.
There's a crash in the main field.
There's a crash, there's about 14 riders down in the middle of the main field. Looking down at the side of the road, the orange jerseys of Euskaltel, Euskadi, there's a number of them gone down very hard.
Well, the man who suffered the most has undoubtedly been Iban Mayo, who went down on Stage 3 and lost nearly 4 minutes as the pack all fought for position approaching a dangerous section of cobbles. The Spaniard was expected to attack Lance Armstrong in the mountains this year. Now he's so far behind, he'll have no choice. Roberto Heras, another Spanish climber, was also caught up in that crash, but his team paced him back to the main group. Heras has had a good week, staying out of trouble and within striking distance of Armstrong, the man he helped to victory last year and hopes to beat this year.
Crash! Shoot! Shoot all the bulletins, as the race radio is shouting to us.
Perhaps the biggest story of the tour was that Tyler Hamilton hadn't crashed. In fact, the man with the loyalty card at casualty had been busy coming to the aid of his teammate.
Now this is Robbie McCune, who's gone down in the green jersey, and he's probably the best bike rider in the race.
Jan Ullrich has been almost invisible for the first 7 days, intelligently riding close to the front and ghosting past the pilots. The only casualty on Team Mobile has been one of his helpers, Rolf Aldag, who couldn't decide which side of a traffic island to take and ended up going into the man in front of him. There's no doubt this is the most crash-ridden tour in recent memory, and not even Armstrong can claim immunity. Stage 7 took the race up out of the Loire Valley, almost to the Brittany coast, 196 kilometres from Châteaubriant to Saint-Brieuc. And almost immediately, the tour registered its 100th crash victim, Sven Montgomery of Gerolsteiner, down and out of the race with a broken collarbone. With the points competition so close, McEwen and O'Grady were going at it out on the road. With a two-man break out front, they were both sprinting for third place, and McEwen looked clearly faster. He took O'Grady at the second intermediate sprint, despite the Cofidis man having a teammate lead him out, and repeated the trick at the third. So from 2 points down, he was now 2 points up, and ownership of the green jersey was going to come down to the finish. On the run-in, the two-man break was caught, but another attack of seven riders was launched almost immediately, and from it, three men pulled away. Francisco Manthebo of Illes Baleares, Iker Flores in the orange of Euskaltel, and Filippo Pozzato in the blue and white of Fassa Bortolo.
This is a big attack by Flores, and he's spread eagle this breakaway of seven, and there's no sign of the peloton. We are inside 2 kilometres to go. This is the break that will decide the day. Scarponi has come back right up to him. If it comes to a straight sprint, Scarponi surely will be favourite.
Watch out for Filippo Pozzato, who's going now.
Sorry, that's Pozzato, quite right.
The blue and white there of Fassa Bortolo. Dragging himself up there is Mancebo. This man has got a very gangly position, but he's in fine form. He's just dragging himself back up. The group has been split into two. I'm surprised Paolo Bettini is caught in the second half of the acceleration.
Well, Paolo is a very crafty bike rider. He might well come back yet, but Pozzato's riding his first Tour de France. He's in the middle of these three as the Balearic Islands now head for the finish here. This is Mancebo, who's a very good climber, and he's pinching a few seconds over the big boys here.
And he's also the Spanish national champion. Now then, this group has split into two. Iker Flores is in a bit of difficulty there in third position on the road. Mancebo needs to keep riding. Pozzato is going to be very cool. This man has won a lot of races already since turning professional. He's in second position in the blue and white jersey. He is in the ideal position to take out the sprint. Iker Flores in the orange jersey, just trying to pull himself back into the race.
Well, he is pulling Pozzato to the victory here for sure if he keeps this up, because he wants time over the field. The other boys just want the stage win. Mancebo looks over his shoulder. He'll see Pozzato. Pozzato, by the way, was the rider who finished second to the Irish rider Mark Scanlon in the Junior World Championships a few years ago. And Scanlon also riding his first Tour de France this year. But it looks like Pozzato is setting himself up, coming right on his back wheel, Flores. But Pozzato has gone. This is a very, very difficult finish to go that far out. But I think Pozzato should have the strength now. But look at Flores, no chance. Filippo Pozzato for Fassa Bortolo. Then comes Flores, then comes Mancebo, and the pack are right on the heels of the rest of them. But I think Brochard, is he just going to hang on? Well, yes, he is, from Sebastian Eno on the line. And the green jersey right there of Stuart O'Grady.
The youngest man in the race and the third Tour debutant to win a stage, 22-year-old Filippo Pozzato, probably knew he had it as soon as he recognised the two Spanish climbers he was up against. A great win nonetheless, and much clearer than the sprint for the minor points going on behind him. Tor Hushoff led the bunch home, Stuart O'Grady in the green jersey came across in 10th place, while Robbie McEwen, tired at the end of a long day in the wind, was 13th. And that was enough for O'Grady to hold on to the green jersey by a single point. The competition was hotting up behind him, though. Third and fourth, Danilo Hondo and Eric Zabel were also separated by just a point, and Tor Hushovd had moved up into fifth. It started the week as Fabian Cancellara's cast-off. When the young Swiss claimed all the jerseys by winning the prologue, he took yellow and green passed down to the next man in the standings, which just happened to be Lance Armstrong. He was hardly going to risk his chances of a sixth Tour win by getting his elbows out in the bunch sprints, so on stage one, it was up for grabs. Tor Hushov took one intermediate sprint on the road and third place on the stage, and that was enough to put a proper blue-collar worker in the green jersey. The next man to take it was a former winner of the competition overall, Robbie McEwen, and with finishes of second, first and third on consecutive days, he was setting the standard of consistency for everyone to beat. Out on the road, though, Stuart O'Grady was being smart. Knowing he couldn't match McEwen for straight speed in a bunch finish, he got himself into a breakaway, promptly won all three intermediate sprints plus the stage itself without any competition from the real sprinters. Very smart. That away day was worth over 50 points, and suddenly Stewie was in contention. When McEwen got caught in the pile-up at the 1 kilometre banner the following day, the finishing straight was clear for O'Grady. His second place to Tom Bonan was enough to take the jersey by 2 points. Of course, yesterday, McEwen started paying more attention to the intermediate sprints and beat O'Grady in both of the ones they contested. But at the end of a punishing day in the Brittany wind, it was O'Grady who gritted his teeth slightly harder at the finish, and his 10th place versus Robbie's 13th kept him in green by a single point. With Thomas Voeckler safely in yellow, the green jersey competition was the main attraction on stage 8 too. 168 kilometres from Lombal west almost to the coast and Camper. At the first sprint of the day, Tor Hushov took first place and 6 points. Robbie McEwen took second and 4 points. Stuart O'Grady was nowhere to be seen. So McEwen had gone from 1 point behind to 3 points ahead of his fellow Australian. Well, the first of the daily crashes happened with just over 8 kilometres to go. Samuel Dumoulin was the chief victim as the pack left him behind, heading at high speed for another tight run into the finish in Camper.
And now inside, 5 kilometres from the finish, as still two teams believe they're carrying the day's winner. But now we're seeing the arrival, too, of the Lotto riders. Robbie McEwen won't be far away. The green jersey of Stuart O'Grady is also moving to the front. He will fancy this is a good scoring opportunity for him. And off to our picture, I've seen Paolo Bettini. He fancies this because it is a sharp uphill before the line, and also the Italian former champion in Salvatore Camesso. All riders believing now they're in with a shout today.
Well, Robbie McEwen will like this finish as a very nasty left-hand corner at 250 metres to go. In the past there, we've seen Robbie McEwen cruising around these corners, especially in the wet. It's as if it's dry for him. Don't forget, Robbie McEwen in the past started his career off as a BMX rider, and he's probably one of the best bike handlers in this event. Picking their way around the first of this big repetition of traffic roundabouts on the outskirts of Camper. There are 6 of these in the final 5 kilometres. Fortunately, I've got my breath held here to see whether or not everybody's going to get around safely. At the back end of the pack, you can see how riders are picking their way around here very precariously.
Well, I have to say that that has knocked a lot of the wind out of quite a lot of riders there who've lost enormous distance by making that corner through the roundabout. It'll take a huge effort now for these boys at the back. Their day is probably over now, and it's going to go the front end that's going to decide this race. There are more roundabouts to come. There's a very sharp climb. Just look how far behind now the men at the back of the peloton. For them, the day is over. The riders at the front will try to keep the pace high. They will take them into the roundabouts at high speed, and if they can't come out at high speed, they'll be on the floor. And still controlling the race at the front is Quickstep, and looking now for the victory too. Cloden is also moving up behind in that white jersey, the champion of Germany.
Cloden will be looking after Eric Zabel. You can see they've got the main field stretched out into a very long line. This is again to exaggerate the point of why the big contenders, Armstrong, Ullrich, Hamilton, Leipheimer, ride near the front end of the main field. This field could split on the run into the finish, and you've spent the whole day sitting in the pack, and just because there's a split down towards the end, you can lose 5, 10 or even 30 seconds to one of your challengers. Christophe Moreau whipping up the pace, but there's a big battle now happening between 6th and 10th place. The sprinters are all looking for the wheel that they want to follow. There is Eric Zabel, nice and comfortable in about 10th position, but Robbie McEwen is right to the fore. McEwen currently holds the lead in the green jersey points race, and he will want to try and get across the line ahead of Stuart O'Grady, who is the man wearing that green jersey, and O'Grady himself has been very close to the front end of the pack.
3 kilometres to go now for the whole field that's surviving in today's stage of the Tour de France. David Bramati continues. Cloden here looking over to his teammates to see the gaps are forming there, because one or two riders beginning to bottle out now on the slippery road surfaces. They know that the sprinters are forcing the way to the front. That is always by design. This is by nature a very tough type of rider to finish. The sprinters will be pushing and shoving. If they get caught, of course, they get fined or disqualified, but they've got to get caught first. It's a tough man's sport at the end of a stage when the whole field rush for the line. As they head now for 2 kilometres to go, all of a sudden it's thinning out a little bit at the front.
Michael Rogers on the front. This man's got a very big turn of speed. He's thinking about just one thing. He wants to make sure that they keep the line, a long stretched out line. They're inside 2 kilometres right now. What he is doing this for is his own teammate, the young kid from Belgium, Tom Boonen, 23 years of age, winning a stage in the Tour de France at his first attempt. They've got another teammate up there as well in third position. You can see the rider attacking there from...
Oh, no, it's Ilbeliers.
That's Stefano Zanini will take up this one because he's in about third position. Il Baleares, the Balearic Islands team, have been very aggressive over the last couple of days. But look at Zanini coming round there. There's another crash at the back end of the main field, but we'll stay at the front end of the pack.
We might well switch if our camera gets hold of it, but Vicente Garcia da Costa is pushing on now for the Il Baleares team. He's been marshalled. He tried it yesterday, remember, and the light blue jerseys are trying to bring up now Danilo Hondo. There's Bettini, and there is the crash, and it's a Cofidis rider, I think, who has gone down. It looked to me as though it was Yannick Tombach. He's a sprinter. Well, he's out of this sprint, but he can, of course, get into the finish. That's really sad, but it seems to me whenever there's a crash, there's a Cofidis boy in trouble. Back to the front, and watch out for the boy in the white jersey with the red spots now.
Stefano Zanini on the front, looking a little bit further back. You can see Paolo Bettini. Gerald Steiner swinging off. Robbie McEwen is not far away. Bettini are about to take up the pacemaking at the front, but there is a green jersey of Stuart O'Grady. In the middle, the pink jersey's on the shoulders of Eric Zabel. We're getting to the difficult part now. They're looking to see when they're going to notice the 1 kilometre to go. There's still a couple more sprints to go and a couple more corners. Bettini's got the acceleration.
This is the one he wanted. This is a strong finish for Bettini. Koos Moerenhout, I think it is, who's latched up. No, it's Robbie McEwen himself who's latched onto the back wheel there.
Good acceleration there. Stuart O'Grady's been caught out. He's waiting for somebody else to make the acceleration. They're inside of 1,000 metres to go, but that was the move that everybody was waiting for. Paolo Bettini was waiting to pounce. He's leapt off the front, and this might be just the right moment. McEwen right on his wheel.
Well, that's incredible. McEwen has got onto his wheel. He doesn't know what to do here. He wants to win. He's even talking to Bettini as he goes past now. They're inside the last 600 metres to go, and they couldn't open the sprint because of the nature of the finish. McEwen has waited for the field to catch up and retake his place in a crucial stage of the race. Well, McEwen read the move, but Bettini went just that little bit too early now, as we've got an attack now by Kim Kirken.
Kim Kirken, he's got the gap of Vasa Bortolo. This would be remarkable. Two wins in 2 days if he can just hold off the front of the main field. Yesterday was Filippo Pizzato. This is the Luxembourg national champion with a slight gap over the front end of the main field. Crédit Agricole have got their man Tor Hushov right up there in second position on his wheel. You can just see there tucked in is Eric Zabel, then it's Stuart O'Grady, then coming up there is Tom Boonen. The sprinters may well have just been caught out. This is the corner at 250 metres to go.
They line up for the finish. Kim Kirken looking for win at number three of the season. May well have done it right. Tor Hushov, the reason the boys in green and white have worked so hard, is coming to the front and he's going to get the stage win. It's all worked out for Crédit Agricole. That's what they wanted. Tor Hushov gets the points. He'll be right up in that green jersey competition. He raced into the yellow, became Norway's first race leader early last week. He started off this second week of the Tour de France in similar style.
Tor Hushov taking the most macho stage win celebration prize of the Tour to date, after Paolo Bettini had confused everybody by jumping off the front far too early in the King of the Mountains jersey. Kim Kirken was second, Eric Zabel was third again, and Robbie McEwen a crucial fourth against O'Grady's eighth in terms of the points competition. Well, there aren't many people who would look at the weather on a day like this and say, isn't it good? But a Norwegian would.
It was cold today and windy, it was rainy, and I was just like laughing about the rain. Sometimes it doesn't care. I was like motivated today because I was waiting for my day, and finally today I did it.
And in the process, he moved up in the green jersey competition. 25 points off the lead at the start of the day, he'd moved to within 11. The lead, though, was still alternating between the two Aussies, and now back with Robbie McEwen, who'd fought back impressively after losing it in that Stage 6 crash.
It's always good to be in the lead, rather than trying to chase points down.
You know, I got in the situation last year where I crashed and I was in the jersey. I was suddenly 20 points behind, had to make it up, and it's really difficult. Now I've crashed again in the jersey this year and, you know, missed out on, you know, 25, 30, 35 points, and now I'm in the lead, but it's only slender, and there's anything can happen. Yeah, there's a long way to go.
All right, let's wrap up the other competitions now. And although the mountains don't really start until after the rest day, Paolo Bettini has usually been first over what climbs we've seen so far. He retains the polka dot jersey, which he's had pretty much since the start of the race. And Thomas Voeckler holds on to the race lead ahead of his fellow escapees from stage five, with Lance Armstrong the nearest big name, 9.5 minutes back in sixth. That cushion is going to be pulled from under him pretty smartly once the serious climbing starts, but the popular Frenchman at least has the honour of carrying the yellow jersey into the rest day.
Déjà, c'est une bonne chose d'arriver à la journée de repos avec avec le maillot jaune. Et demain, je vais essayer de décompresser un peu dans la tête et puis physiquement. Et après, on va voir comme on a fait jusque-là, étape par étape, tous les jours, voir comment ça se passe, donner le maximum et puis voir au jour le jour.
Well, as I say, it won't take many days in the mountains before the serious contenders relieve Thomas Voeckler of the pressure of being at the top, and here's how they'll stack up coming out of the rest day. Lance Armstrong, the defending champion, is 6th, 36 seconds ahead of Tyler Hamilton, who's 11th. Jan Ullrich is 20th and 55 seconds behind Armstrong. Then come the Spanish climbers, Roberto Heras, 1:45 down in 36th place, and Iban Mayo, 5.5 minutes back in 89th. They'll all move up over the next week. Sebastian Joly probably won't. He's already nearly an hour down in 176th and last place.
Yes, thanks, Gary. Just time for one or two questions. Interesting one here from Harry Hailwood, who comes from Barnes. Harry, you're asking how many other riders have made their Tour debut and taken out victory in the prologue, like the Swiss cyclist Fabian Cancellara yesterday. Well, in fact, there have been four, Paul.
Yeah, the first man to do it was the Italian Francesco Moser back in 1975. A couple of years later, Dietrich Thurau from Germany did the same thing. Then a bit of a gap to Eric van der Aarden from Belgium. But then 1994, Chris Boardman did the same thing in Lille, and he set the fastest ever prologue record there at 55 kilometres an hour. And before anybody writes in, David Miller won the opening stage of the Tour de France in his first attempt, but that was a long time trial stage, not an individual prologue.
That's right, not a bad memory, Paul. Anyway, let's move on. Ellen Cheatham from Ufcombe in Devon. Ellen, we seem to get this question every year. Why do cyclists shave their legs? So we thought we'd let Bradley McGee tell you the answer.
I don't know what the traditional role it is. It's definitely just, for me as an athlete, firstly, massaged every day. It just feels clean. It feels right. Yeah, I've been doing it since I was 15 years old, so it's more natural to do it than not to do it. So, yeah.
Thanks, Brad. OK, Ellen, there you are. Let's move on now to Terry Jones from Newcastle. Were my eyes deceiving me, or are Skoda really sponsoring the cars in the Tour de France? The answer is yes. It's the first year of a new contract for Skoda after Fiat pulled out last year.
Now, before the Tour, almost everyone seemed to have circled stage 16, the time trial about Duez, as being the day that would most likely decide the outcome of the race. Almost everyone.
I don't think that, let me just put it this way, I don't think the critical stages of the Tour de France are going to be in the Alps. I think they're, for me and in my opinion, in between just us and all the American viewers, I think it goes down before then.
It was unlikely to be going down on stage 9, though. It was the shortest road stage of the race, 160 kilometres from San Leonardo Noblat to Guéret, with nothing more testing than a couple of fourth category climbs. But even they were too much for Yann Kersipou. The winner of stage 1 back in Charleroi had been suffering before the rest day, and he abandoned early in the stage. Two riders then managed to escape the bunch, Inigo Landaluze of Euskaltel and Filippo Simeone of Domino Vacanze. With the peloton putting the hammer down to pull them in on the closing stages, it was touch and go whether they'd survive, and Simeone's teammates were worried enough to be up at the front, trying to get in amongst the pursuers and disrupt their rhythm.
10 kilometres to go now for the two leaders. It's still there, it's still possible. 1:33 the gap. The peloton attempts to disrupt the chase by teammates of Simeone, not going down well with certain members of the bunch.
It certainly isn't. It's difficult to understand the pressure that these riders are on who are chasing at the front end of the main field, and they are pushed to the point of actually making almost animal decisions. It's a decision that you don't make literally, it's just something that you react to. And if somebody's coming alongside barging you while you're trying to do a job like this, sometimes you make a decision that you wouldn't in a nice, cold, calm atmosphere. But it's not cold and calm, the atmosphere in the front end of the main field. Everyone is fighting for survival. Everyone is trying to do their job at the front end of the main field. And tempers today are starting to flare.
They are, and this is a nasty split in the road here as they go either side through what is a narrow street at best of times. We're racing now up to 9 kilometres to go for the leaders. These boys are probably at 10 kilometres as the split there has been done safely. Oh, no, it hasn't, because that was a crash at the bottom of our picture. Somebody clipped somebody, and this was the danger. And Voeckler have a man down there. And a couple of Elias Belieris riders. That's Gonzalez who's gone down.
Riders. This was at the back end of the pack. Somebody's gone down very hard on the far side as well. And it was right in the middle. In fact, you see the one rider who went down, it was his own fault, because in fact he was switching across from the left-hand side to the road to the right, and he actually hit one of those directional signs in the middle of the road. I'm trying to see who is really down and hurt quite badly, and it's one of the riders from CSC. It could be Kurt Arbison, who in fact was a rider who a couple of days ago who'd had an injury out on the road. He didn't look too good, and I think, in fact, Arvidsson was the first rider to go down and then got catapulted across the road. Just looking here to see exactly who it was, but he does not look very good at all. The race doctor is up alongside, and you can see here just exactly how it happened. It was, in fact, the man who went down, I feel fairly certain, was the CSC rider. Somebody went right off into the crowd on the right-hand side. And we're just having a look down here to see just exactly who it is. The man with the blue coat on there is the Dr. Gerard Port. This guy has gone down very hard indeed.
Well, I'm not sure whether that isn't Kurt Atle Arvidsson, because he's got flashes on his... Has he got flash on his sleeve? I'm not sure, Paul.
I'm not sure. He was a rider who was involved in an accident couple of days ago, and he had a very nasty cut to his thigh. And this man had a big bandage on his thigh as well, so I'm fairly certain it could well have been Kurt Atle Arvidsson. He went down hard, he's back up on his bike, and it is Arvidsson. He's up and riding.
New bike for him, Paul, because I reckon he smashed that one to pieces. He went clean over the top of the falling rider. 4 kilometres to go. They are 3/4 of a kilometre behind the two leaders at the moment. Officially, it's 40 seconds to them. The gendarme again warning of a tight bend here as we swoop through the town of Guéret, and then we go out the other side of it. These two boys went away at 37 kilometres today. They planned an attack, if it were to succeed, of 123 kilometres. They've got just 4 kilometres to go. And now a big effort by the Basque rider Landaluz, but Simeone's with him.
They may well just survive, you know, because they've got a fairly good advantage. They're outside of the 30-second mark. The main field, though, is absolutely splintering at the front end because of the pressure and the difficult nature of the running. There's McEwen pulling his way up through the middle of the main field. McEwen is obviously thinking about getting himself a few more points. It's 35 seconds, and this is a great move here coming off the front by the FDJ.com team. But the reason to do that is to try and whip up the pace, I think, for Baden-Cook.
That's what we would assume. It actually looks like Carlos de Cruz here has got himself up to the front. He was the rider, had the flat tyre, and got back just before that big crash. He's trying to get away now.
Well, I thought it was Carlos de Cruz, but I couldn't believe that he'd got back into the main field. It looks very much like the shape and form of Carlos de Cruz trying to whip up the face at the front end of the main field. That's 3 kilometres to go right now. Landaluz getting nervous, looking back to see what the gap is. You can see the race referee there trying to pull everybody out of this gap. The reason for that is because the main field are absolutely boring down upon these two riders.
Well, they've still got to rise up. We're out the backside of the town now. We go out onto a highway, and then we swing back for a finish on a brand new road made especially for the arrival of the Tour de France, and to take out a roundabout which would have been at 200 metres to go. They are under 3 kilometres to go now. We are talking seconds. I can't see them surviving, but I'd love them to.
Well, they could. It's 25 seconds, but look how long that big main field is stretched out completely. Simeone looking over his shoulder. He wants to see if there's any sign of weakness in the eyes of Inigo Landaluz.
Looking over his shoulder.
Landaluz in the orange jersey has never had a victory in his whole career, and he turned professional 4 years ago. 2 kilometres to go. These riders dare not now start to make any tactical manoeuvring, because if they do, they will get wiped out immediately.
We are talking of slightly more than 1 mile in old money as we race for the line, and the peloton are not being timed currently, but it can't be more than 16 or 17 seconds. These boys are slightly ahead of the rest as they continue now. The crash may have just done enough to disturb the rhythm to give them the victory. There's the three riders who are being brought up now. They are saying 20 seconds at 2 kilometres. Surely that is possible.
It's completely and utterly possible. If these two riders don't start to mess around and look for tactical manoeuvring in the sprint, they could just hang off the front of the main field and probably could see a situation here where they'd be given the same time as the main field, because I think the main field will just come onto their wheels.
A flick of the arm there by Simeone, and Landaluce didn't seem to want to come through there. This is the turn back towards town now to give us the new road eventually that has been specially built for the finish. There is the last 1,000 metres, and the peloton, who have given it their best shot, may have misjudged it by two guys who broke away after 37 kilometres. Now, Simeone doesn't want to go through now, and calling him through is Landaluce. Here comes the cavalry.
Charging into town right now. They are looking for the final kilometre flag. There is Stefano Zanini in third place. Right on his wheel was Tom Boonen. Moving up through the middle is the green jersey of Robbie McEwen. Around the corner is the two leaders. They should not get caught. They will, I think, survive over this last 500 metres. But who is going to take out the victory? It's a shame, you know, when you've got a two-man breakaway like this, because somebody has to lose.
Simeone's won 7 races in a career, which began back in 1995. The guy in orange has never won a race, and this is his 4th year as a pro. They cannot afford to mess around. It's a slightly uphill finish. If you wait, you're dead, because the peloton are on your tail, and it's a big lead out now. And I can see the pink jersey of Eric Zabel looking for the win. Tor Hushoff is brilliantly placed in second wheel, and Robbie McEwen is boxed in that green jersey. Here comes the charge now. Filippi Simeone has got to go all of the way. He can't wait. He's giving Landaluce the perfect lead out. One thing's for sure, everybody will finish in the same time. Cam, they got the legs. Here comes Hushoff. Here comes Tom Boonen now. There goes the bouncing Robbie McEwen as they get to the line. Landaluce is going to be passed by McEwen and Hushoff one-on-one as they hit the line. And it's gone to the Australian. Robbie McEwen has won the stage at Tour de France.
Unbelievable. You feel so sorry for those two guys who were off the front, but they messed about just a little bit in the last 500 metres. And what a great comeback by all of the sprinters. Robbie McEwen got his wheel across the line, I think, just ahead of Stuart O'Grady, and on the other side, Eric Zabel.
A great finish, and so close that even the winner headed straight for the nearest TV set after he crossed the line to watch the replay and make sure.
Yes! Oh, what a fantastic victory in the green jersey. And after my crash a few days ago, I'm still suffering a lot with my knee, but I was still able to win the stage. It's just incredible.
And as a result, Robbie's lead in the green jersey competition had doubled. Tor Hushoff's second place on the stage was enough for him to overtake Stuart O'Grady. O'Grady retained his second place in the overall standings, though, a few seconds closer now to Thomas Voeckler, with Lance Armstrong still 6, 9.5 minutes back.